Good evening and welcome to the regular town board meeting for the town of Tustin for June the 8th, 2021. If you please rise and join me in the pledge to the flag.
United States of America, and public for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all, sometimes.
A couple of announcements. The first one we don't have on there, but there is a flyer out regarding early voting information for the 2021 primary election and polling sites. And that can be found at the Sullivan County Board of Elections office or on Sullivan County, New York's website. It begins Saturday, June the 12th and runs through June the 20th. A letter from the Sullivan County Treasurer's Office. Reference Sullivan County room tax. I am enclosing a copy of the newly revised Sullivan County Hotel and Motel Room Occupancy Tax Law, which was recently enacted by the legislature. The law has been updated to redefine a lodging facility as any shelter being used for lodging on an overnight basis, which is not owned and or provided by the occupant. Several other revisions were made. I strongly urge you to review the new law in its entirety. As I am sure you are aware, the number of property owners who are renting their property as a vacation short-term rental on their own or through third parties is increasing exponentially. In fact, many of our local municipalities have enacted their own local laws concerning these short-term rentals. I'm contacting every town and village to ask for help. I understand that these property owners may not be aware of our hotel and motel room occupancy tax law. If you know of any property owners who regularly rent their property on a short-term basis, I would ask that you refer these residents to our office so that we may have them properly register as a rental facility. If you prefer, you can provide my office with the residents' information and we will reach out to them to ensure they are in compliance. The office wants to ensure that any properties that are rented on a short-term basis are in compliance with all local and state laws and building codes. I am reaching out to you with the hope that we can work together and ensure that this is accomplished. Sincerely, Nancy Buck, the Sullivan County Treasurer.
It doesn't say what the rate is. It's still 5%.
I believe it is still 5%. The next is an email regarding reckless driving incidents. This is also CC'd to Captain Navarro of the New York State Police. I'm writing once again to ask that police action be taken to curtail, if not stop entirely, the vicious and reckless drivers who are terrorizing Narrowsburg residents. As the warmer weather arrived, the winter hiatus Trooper Jim Gore had secured from the hot rod racers has gone, and once again, the streets of Narrowsburg reverberate with screeching tires and the whine of over-accelerated engines. Over this past weekend, the cacophony of racing cars and trucks was almost unbearable, aggravated further by an invasion of competing motorcycle groups of biker boys and girls. Once at the beginning of the weekend, there was one afternoon when a state police car shielded by the UDC building on Bridge Street stood sentry for these disruptions. But in a marked car, his presence was soon known and broadcast by Jungle Telegraph to all who might need to mind their speed and sound for the duration. After that day, though, the state police presence disappeared. There was, for most of the time, a speed tracking monitoring sign operating on Bridge Street. Even a cursory check of that recorded record should reveal that except for the one day that the trooper was there, the speeds down Bridge Street and across the bridge continued to be out of control. Tonight, there was one incident that I would like to bring your attention, mainly because of the whole thing should have been captured by surveillance cameras at the Sunoco gas station next to the car wash and Pizza Plaza off Kirk Road. At approximately 4:10 p.m., a brown Dodge 4x4 pickup truck was idling next to a Jeep. These parties seemed to know one another, were joking back and forth until the Jeep was gassed up. At that point, the driver of the truck started gunning his engine and then popped the clutch and started to roll forward with a very loud noise and a huge mushroom cloud of black smoke pouring from the steamboat type stack above the cab. Usually these vehicles leap forward, but this time enveloped in a huge cloud of black smoke, the truck only moved forward only very slowly. The driver seemed enraged and kept gunning the engine, but the truck only crept ahead, enveloped in a very increasing cloud of black and white smoke coming out of the exhaust stack and from under the cab respectively, with the driver repeatedly gunning the engine over and over to get the truck moving. At one point, the station attendant asked the Jeep driver what was happening, and the Jeep driver made some derisive comment that he thought the truck driver was an idiot was going to blow off the stack. After a few more false starts, the truck engine finally caught, and with billowing clouds of black and white smoke roared out of the lot onto Kirk Road heading up to Bridge Street. I do not know if the truck driver went straight ahead on Erie Ave or turned right on the Bridge Street, but you could hear the roar of the engine long after the truck was no longer in sight. Everything that transpired in and around the gas station lot should have been clearly captured by station cameras. I'm asking for the record that someone from the state police review any surveillance cameras at this Sunoco gas station for the date and the time in question. The incident recorded there is not unique to our area. The only difference is that this time there's a video record of it. Sunday, June the 6th at about 4:10 p.m. Just before all this transpired, another dark red truck drove across the Pete's parking lot parallel to the gas station at an accelerating speed and with roaring engines and screeching tires turned up Kirk Road. I don't know if this was captured by camera video, but you certainly could hear the noise on the soundtrack of the video. I can only hope that given that the video of all this all too frequent incidents, state police can do something about this. Once again, the same and worse problems that plagued Narrowsburg residents last October, as reported multiple times by myself and others, are back with a vengeance. The speed tracking sign should be able to produce a valuable record of at least how many vehicles at what time on a given day are repeatedly traveling at dangerous, excessive speeds in the hamlet. Given the emerging pattern, law enforcement officers should be set up to monitor what is going on and to act to stop the abuse. If officers are dispatched, they should be set up in unmarked cars as a word the police are back and monitoring driving in the hamlet. Spreads like wildfire to the offending parties. I have heard the police may not use unmarked vehicles as this would be considered entrapment. I looked up the word entrapment as used in this context, and it says it is only considered entrapment if the action entices someone to do something they would not ordinarily do. These motorized marauders don't need any enticement to drive with reckless abandon and complete disregard for the welfare of others. I would also like to thank Trooper Jim Gore, who on or about February 18th was called to meet with and discuss the situation with one of the main offenders. I don't know what he said, but whatever it was, he was able to elicit assurances from some of the marauders that they would try to avoid Main Street and tone down the noise. Whether he was actually able to make them pay attention or if it was just the daddy took some race cars and trucks off the street for the winter for the car's protection, not the pedestrians, from that point on until warmer weather came back in late March, early April, there was a blessed but sadly all too brief period when the racers could not be heard and peace, safety, and quiet prevailed. I understand that one of the racers might have recently been interdicted by a patrolling trooper. The traffic sign surveillance record could result in another slapdown of these moronic delinquents. I and many of my fellow townspeople would be eternally grateful. Thank you for reviewing and hopefully acting on this matter, Star Hess. The payment of bills. The general fund expended $37,790.71, the highway $40,863.49, the water fund $13,470.38, the sewer fund $16,069.25, for a total of $108,193.83. Bruce and Jill audited the bills. Were there any questions?
Not at all.
Nope. I would entertain a motion to pay the bills as presented. I have a motion from Jill. A second?
I'll second.
I have a second from Jane. All in favor?
Aye.
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 Division reports. The highway department used 694 gallons of diesel, 515 was for the highway, and 180 was for non-highway. Used 142 gallons of gas, 3 was for the highway, and 138 was for non-highway use. They've been patching holes. They chip sealed Evergreen, Maple, Eagle View, and Swamp Pond. Cut trees on Swamp Pine, Chalk, and Brook. Swept the roads, repaired the washouts, and graded Hankins Road. And they are preparing the roads for paving. The water and sewer, they completed the monthly drinking water and wastewater sampling and reporting. They made adjustments to the chlorinator at the plant as needed to maintain federal and state regular standards on the effluent wastewater. Meter readings every Wednesday in the month of May. At attended a class by New York Rural Water Association, along with several webinars for sewer and water education. Sludge was pumped from the dosing tanks. It had one after hours water leak. They installed the water meters and turned water onto three buildings. They pumped three septic tanks. They verified a potential water leak on Route 97. They repaired the valve box for sand bed number three, and they mowed the grass in the water and sewer properties. Their financial report, their water meter rent was $55.92.22, service charge of 21 with a water penalty of $66.92. Received from the water department $5,680.14. Sewer rents for $16,397.26. Service charge of $6, sewer penalties of $203.28, for a total received of $16,606.54. The building department had 21 construction inspections, a 4 certificate of occupancies, 10 building permits, 1 new home, 1 renovation alteration, 1 camping, 1 commercial deck, 1 demolition, 2 electrical permits, 2 logging permits, 1 septic permit. They had 12 CO and violation searches. The inspector and the clerk attended training on residential enforcement for 1.5 hours and part 2 for 1.5 hours. The clerk attended training on 514 for 1 hour in 2 different sections. Monies collected by the office from May 1 to May 31 was $2,779.90. The assessor's office, the month of May, got off to a slower start with tax rolls and notices being billed, not being ready for until the May the 3rd. They were post office was closed on May the 3rd. During May, he's required to present the tax roll 4 times for 4 hours each time. These times were not used by the taxpayers and no calls were received. The time was used on paperwork and double checking input of computer for accuracy. The quarterly sales report was run and forwarded to the Department of Taxation. Sullivan County Assessors Association did not meet in May. The normal training for the grievance day for the Grievance Board of Review was not held in person. Grievance day was quiet with only complaint being of a solar array parcels for Homeland Farms. These values are under the New York State solar exemption for a 15-year period. The town assessed value increased $683,228 from 2020. While there were many building permits issued, many were for smaller item and assessment increases, therefore were less. Several new home permits were in the very beginning stages and again were not of full value for 2021.
Hold on. The grievance day, very quiet, these values are an exemption for a 15-year appeal, but Delaware River Solar wants the values reduced.
Get that.
They didn't get it.
No.
Okay, that was, did we say that though?
No, because they have one more, I believe they got one more.
Okay, so I'm just double checking. Yep. Okay, good.
And Susan, are you here from the Upper Delaware Council?
Okay, now, yes I am. Can you hear me?
Yep.
Okay, great. So I'll tell you what, when I sent my report to Crystal, I forgot the most important thing, and it's the approval of our comp plan by the Park Service. I don't know if Peter Manning is here somewhere, but yes?
He's not here. I wasn't saying good.
And at any rate, I'll just... I'll tell you what I know. He called Cody at the Park Service and asked it what's happening. When I met with everybody on Thursday, we had an in-person meeting, and both Cody and our Shannon Salento were mystified why the Park Service has not responded. They didn't understand it. They don't get it. So anyway, Peter apparently spoke to Cody and asked if there was a time thing that they had to respond. No, there isn't. So what was decided, what's suggested by the UDC, is that the town go forward with the condition on approval of the comp plan, conditional on NPS response. So not to hold it up further, but to go forward. And this Peter will talk to you all about. And a side note is that MPS has never actually overridden the UDC on a substantial conformance. So it's just bureaucratic. I think it's just delay. Our Park Service has experienced these kinds of delays, as in getting the Boy Scout lease approved. It's been very, very, very slow. So anyway, I think that's a great suggestion, is to go forward and just insert that language. It's conditional on Park Service approval. And then where am I? The TMR access. Joe got into the lease agreement and he received permission from his over people to have the lease agreement executed. But now the Boy Scouts are delaying, so they still don't have a lease agreement. And therefore, they were not there on Memorial Day weekend. So we can only hope that that will resolve itself. I suggested that he speak with, that he keep Town of Tustin in the loop, since we've been dealing with the Boy Scouts all forever and might have some helpful suggestions. Regarding the boat launch, big project, it's discussed at the Worm meeting, which Evan Padua, our alternate, is a member. And so I'm really only aware that it's on their agenda and it's discussed every time they meet. And my impression is that the progress is quite slow. There's pretty much unanimous. We'd really like to have an improved boat launch there. TMR access, apparently this was surprising, but NPS has apparently made a request to acquire 20 acres of property surrounding the TMR access. Lori discovered this because it was part of a project list released by the Land and Water Conservation Fund. And when Lori asked Joe about it, he seemed to have very mixed feelings, like, I don't know if that's such a good idea. Anyway, just making you all aware that that happened. And nobody has any clue as to how the Boy Scouts would feel about that. Another piece here is historical societies. We were talking about that. And our historical society can obtain transcripts of oral histories, which the NPS has, and they're digitized. The Milanville Bridge, the NPS submitted a lengthy comment supporting rehabilitation of the bridge. Dates, UDC is seeking nominations for their awards, banquet, you know, for every annual awards, and starting on June 25th. Technical assistance grants, which is at the top of this report, projects of historical and cultural value will be considered along with land use planning, and the criteria will be in your application forms and they need to be completed by August 20. So you have the TAG grants, August 20, you have the banquet, which is in September. You have the nominating people for awards anytime after June 25th. And you have next month's meeting. We'll start with a discussion of Sullivan County Rural Broadband by Lauren Green, who is the director of that for Sullivan County. So that might be of real interest to folks. It's an opportunity to ask this gentleman firsthand questions. If you have questions about broadband and cell service, UDC gets really lousy service. And I think at the town hall, we've had our issues as well. So that's next, that's July 1st at 7 o'clock, and that's it. And if anybody has any questions.
I do. Well, I don't have a question. I do have a comment though. Just so that you know, if it comes up again, the Tustin Historical Society has several oral histories as well.
Did they do? Okay, wonderful. Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, I have a feeling that Art probably is perfectly aware of the stuff that the Park Service has, and they've probably gone back and forth, and we probably have a wonderful collection. So.
Okay. Any other questions for Susan? Brandy with the Energy Committee?
Thank you. On April 22nd, Earth Day, the TEC had a virtual ribbon cutting for the town food scrap digester, also known as the horse. Support for Tustin leading the way towards food recovery and creating probiotic plant food as a result has been overwhelming. A few of our highly esteemed supporters are former Senator Jen Metzger, Barbara Ahrenzell, Director of DCS, Assemblywoman Aileen Gunther, DEC, Impact Bioenergy, the Heron, the Botanist, and many more. Thank you to TEC's Scott and Jen. Since the ribbon cutting, the TEC has met many times in the last 2 months in preparation for operating the horse. Four volunteer operators took a training course on site with a chemical engineer from Impact Bioenergy, the makers of the unit. Buckets are ready for distribution to our food merchants as we get ready shortly for operation. There's a TEC tent set up every Saturday at the farmers market at the Union offering informational flyers about the horse. And I want to thank Naomi and Catherine for operating the tent weekly. LED streetlights, the six main streetlights have not yet been installed. As we wait for the closing of the bank building to the town, NYPA will send installers one more time to finish Tustin's install at the bank parking lot, Main Street, and a few other locations. So patients were just waiting on that sequence of events. Main Street will have historic looking iron pendant lanterns, different from the cobra head fixtures all around town. The decision whether or not to purchase and install Wi-Fi nodes is these six lights is the decision of the town board. I just wrote the board, I think it was this morning, just something to consider. Briefly, I said, in order for you all to make an informed decision about the streetlight nodes, here are a few things to consider. Attaches the map of the proposed Wi-Fi locations from Bridge Street through Main Street to Erie Avenue. The Union provides enough Wi-Fi to cover their frontage. All existing businesses along Main Street pay for Wi-Fi inside their shops. But for parades, festivals, and special events in the town, the reception is spotty at best. That's in the street. If we use the $20,000 grant towards these smart cities nodes to supply Wi-Fi for the public, we'd be ensuring more commerce on the streets, more sales, brings in more sales tax dollars. Please note that if Tustin wanted Wi-Fi in the future without the grant, the price would be double. The Smart Cities program was instituted to bring technology to towns in New York State efficiently and at a discounted rate while broadening modes of communication. By using this grant, we would be investing in Tustin as it grows. There's also an option, I just started looking at the numbers, to not include the camera in this program. Below is the cost breakdown I gave to the board. If we didn't use the camera with this program, you could save over $11,000 if cost is the big issue. So that's for you guys to discuss and figure out. So soft plastic. To date, the TEC has collected almost 4.5 tons of soft plastic waste to be recycled by Trex. We believe this program has developed awareness of soft plastic finding its way into our environment. It's an eye-opener to realize just how much plastic is in our lives. We've now received our fourth Trex recycled material bench for our efforts. We donated this bench to the DCS office on Main Street for their years of sustainable initiatives preserving our environment. Star, Sean, and I all collect soft plastic dropped off throughout the town. Thank you to all participants and drop-off locations. And finally, the solar array. There was a letter to the editor in one of the local newspapers recently that sought clarification regarding the Tustin solar array and the horse. I called the owner of the solar array and spoke to him at length. In 2017, the town put out a bid for a power purchase agreement, looking for a company to purchase, install, and maintain the solar array. The town of Tustin awarded it to a solar development company that would install it on the lands at the town barn and maintain the system for 25 years. During that time, 100% of the electricity the solar system generates is for the benefit of the town. There is a list of meters that the solar system benefits each month. By using solar produced the town's electricity, we're saving on the use of fossil fuels. We're proud to say that so far to date, the Tustin Solar Farm has generated 501.6 megawatt hours and has reduced carbon emissions for the town equal to the planting of 8,869 trees or reducing 38,920 gallons of gasoline use. The horse has a new electric service that connects to its town highway outbuilding, which is covered by these solar credits. The horse uses minimal electric annually. The solar panel offset was set up to acknowledging that the town would grow its use in the coming years. So when the TEC said Tustin is the first municipality to own a food scrap digester, it is covered by a municipality solar array in the US. We were referring to all of the above in a nutshell. Green partnerships and efforts like this have helped a small town like Tustin become a New York State certified climate smart community. That's it. Thank you.
Way to go, Brandy.
Does the board have any questions for Brandy?
We change.
Grants.
That'd be me. The UDC Comprehensive Plan Part 2, Sue just gave us good news, and we'll finish off on that during this meeting. And funding is now open for 2022. The town is considering applying for funds to pay a consultant to assist with the completion of the zoning ordinances. Little Lake Erie Culvert, we're waiting to receive the right-of-way approval from one resident. The infrastructure project, we continue with Delaware Engineering to monitor for an appropriate funding opportunity. A public hearing on the water system preliminary engineering report will be June 22nd. Oh, it's 6 o'clock. I have it incorrect on here. At 6 o'clock.
Oh, the public hearing. I'm sorry.
We'll resume the meeting. That's what happens when I interrupt.
So
6:30.
Okay. And after the town board adopts the plan, hopefully, the town will be able to apply for low interest funding through the state revolving fund. So that is really why we're having the recessed meeting to do this, so that it will be approved and then we're eligible to apply for state revolving fund.
We'll start the meeting. We'll complete the secret process. You'd already started that last year. We'll complete the secret process. We'll hold the public hearing, and then you'll take the 202B action, which is basically making findings and issuing the final order for the expansion of the water system. And then you'll adopt the bond resolution. Now that doesn't commit the town to spend a dime on it.
Right.
But it lays the framework, and it's what the engineers will need to then go forward and see whether they can get you some low interest money, and maybe some grant money too.
Right, and if we don't have this done by July 1st, then they would push us to the next year. So we have to do that, yeah. USDA, no word, green infrastructure, no word. That's it.
Any questions for Jane? Okay. Moving into old business, 3.1 hours for temporary assistant to the Narrowsburg Water and Sewer clerk and bookkeeper. Jocelyn has not had to do anything with the bookkeeping. However, she has been doing the hours in the water and sewer, and Kelly has not been doing the hours. So there's no additional cost here, but we would like to keep Jocelyn to stay with the water and sewer temporarily while we're still going through PT with Kelly and stuff. So I would be looking for a motion to keep Jocelyn Strumford, temporary assistant to the water and sewer clerk, town bookkeeper, and confidential secretary, as previously appointed, with the extra time approved by the supervisor as needed. Again, that would be for the regular hours, and it wouldn't be two of them in the water and sewer. Any questions on that at all or comments?
So it's a net even.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. So did you just make a motion?
I will make the motion, yes.
I'll second it.
I have a second by Jane. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed. 3.2, the new water rates for the Narrowsburg Water and Sewer District. Jane, will you look over these and just make sure that I transcribe them properly? Mm-hmm. And then we'll have a discussion on that.
That's fine. The vacant commercial, what is that? 1.5 times the vacant residential?
It should be, yes.
Okay, I'm just going to double check it, and then I think it's fine.
The commercial is half the commercial.
Yes, we went, yeah. We went with half of the commercial.
Yep. Yep. Okay.
Discussion by the board, Al.
Yeah, I first of all, we should let people know that the reason we have to raise these is because nothing's been done for the last 10 years or more as far as raising the rates, and the fact that the cost of producing the water far exceeds the rates that we're getting in, and a tremendous discrepancy between the two. I think also the other thing that we have to look at is the fact that one of the things that I'm concerned with is I don't think that there was a definition of what a commercial customer is. And I think that that has to be done, and it has to be done the correct way to do that. And I think it's through the planning or the zoning board. So I think that's one of the concerns I have. The other concern I have is making this change, which is a tremendous, almost 400% increase. I said almost 400. And I don't know that that's something that everybody is going to be able to handle right away. So I would be in favor of making a step forward, but not a full step forward, a half step forward, and then raising it again next year, the other half.
Had a question on commercial definition for the purpose of the water department.
I think what we should do is we should look at who your actual users are, and I think by definition you're going to be able to figure that out. Commercial is pretty much anything that's not residential.
Anybody with income.
Well, I think the issue is the real question is B&Bs. Yeah. Some people feel it's residential. Some people feel it's commercial.
Well, it depends on what, if you're talking about a bed and breakfast, and I don't know whether there's a distinction between how a B&B is defined in our zoning law versus how the state defines it in the Uniform Fire Prevention Building Code. But under the state code, B&Bs are residential uses. They're for occupancy purposes. It's all by limitation of its definition. That's why it's a very narrow use. It's supposed to be owner occupied. Right. You know, the owner is the host, so to speak, mm-hmm. and lives there.
And that is the definition in our code, is that it's owner occupied. But you could
classify it either way. Just because the building code considers that, I think you need to look. And I think look at what the water consumption is. If your B&Bs are consuming same quantity of water on average as a single family residence is, then you can treat it that way. If they're consuming a greater quantity of water, then you might want to look at them and consider it as a commercial.
One of the other things that we had put in here was you've got a base charge, and with your base charge comes a 9,125 gallons. Once you go over 9,125 gallons, 9,126 to 14 gallons triggers a different price mm-hmm. for that. And then over 14,001 gallons, we've got in there that if it's a residential customer, that they would be changed for that quarter. Their base rent would be right. Commercial.
You got that already built in.
Except that, as Al brings up, we don't have the commercial design very well. We do B&B, and it does say resident, but we're really talking about the house that is not occupied and as an Airbnb, for example. That's a commercial.
So then I would do a residential and not commercial. Okay.
Well, I think that
a discussion has to be had as to how to define a commercial resident, a commercial customer, and that could include B&Bs.
The problem is there's a difference between a B&B and the so-called Airbnb, short-term rental. The difficulty is the short-term rentals, you don't know all of them that are out there. It's going to be very difficult. A lot of them are flying under the radar. Unless you actually go out and start looking at the different places where they advertise these things, the subscription services and what have you. And even then, you won't find them all. It will be difficult.
But the definition of commercial does not affect the rate right now.
Correct.
Well, it doesn't affect, it affects the base rate.
No,
I think that's what Al's saying. He wants to make sure that we've got a proper commercial, because we don't have commercial on the books right now.
We don't have an existing, right.
Well, let me give an example that I gave to Al. This is just an example of one commercial that we would all agree is commercial entity. They used in one quarter 105,255 gallons in one quarter. For that, they paid $377.26, which, if you divide that up, it came to about a third of a cent, a third of 1 cent per gallon. It costs us almost 2 cents per gallon to produce. We have to do something to raise this rate.
Think about this for the short term until we come up with a definition, which we can come up with a definition this next month and change our rates again, or at least define it. If we start out with, we raise the rate to 127, that's going to be for the residential and commercial. And again, this is why we're going to want to get a commercial definition on the book sooner than later, not wait until next year to do it. But let's get the rates in there. Those people that go over the 14,000 gallons and they hit the 14,001, we will have the whatever we want to call it, the new commercial rate for the 190.50 for that particular quarter. And that gives us time to get a rate increase in there. It gives us a couple of weeks to come up with a good definition that's going to, you know, satisfy the likes of those that are going to ask the question.
No, wait, you're losing me. You're saying charge the 127 for residential, and until we define commercial, charge 127?
127, and then...
I don't understand what the problem is here.
Well, I think the problem is that we don't have a definition for commercial.
Okay, then we don't know who to charge the commercial rate. Not, we can establish a commercial rate, but we don't know who to charge that commercial rate. This question we're doing tonight is to approve the rates.
Okay, but what happens in July 1 comes and we have to send out our billing? What are we going to charge the people if we don't have a commercial rate before? Well, I think that's what Al's asking.
No, you're asking that you figure out who is commercial by the July 1st billing, by the July billing. That's what you want to do. This question tonight is,
can we answer
what
that question
are the rates
by July 1? To the satisfaction of the board.
One relatively easy way to do it would be to look at the class code that's signed on the assessment roll for the property. Because there are residential class codes and there are commercial class codes. There are vacant land class codes. So
that's easy.
That would be a very easy way, and it's already been classified as what it is by the assessor.
And then we can add to the commercial properties, meaning the Airbnbs, which are probably not.
They're probably classified as the 200, you know, 210 or depending
which
on
is,
how much land.
So that we can redefine our commercial as we go forward.
Yes, but we then have already established a rate.
Those Airbnbs, those short-term rentals, if you want them to be treated as commercial, they're gonna fly on the array. Yeah. If you do it by the assessment class.
So, how do you feel about that, Al?
I I'm standing by what I originally said. Okay, I really think that you have to define what a commercial
before you can
draw up these rates.
That's what Ken's saying. We'll utilize the tax assessment role, which already has classified.
But as Ken also pointed out, there's going to be quite a few things that run under the radar.
Then it'll be up to the board to redefine what we consider to be commercial. I believe that our assessment role for commercial and residential will be more inclusive than it will be exclusive on commercial and vacant and residential.
This particular rate of commercial is standard. It's quite standard throughout water districts to charge 1.5 times the residential.
He just wants a definite. He is on the commercial
number, who they are.
Correct. Who? What are we going to do? So.
How are we going? That's okay.
Would we define, and Ed, would we need a resolution to define what it is? So the resolution would read that for the purpose of commercial, at this point in time, for the purpose of commercial or residential definitions for the water district in the billing process, that we would use the assessment class codes of the current year's assessment role.
I think that's fine. And then the resolution, I guess once you adopt a definition for commercial, then it would automatically.
Right. We would have to, it would require us to go through the assessment role with all of the accounts that were in the water district and ensure that they are.
Yeah.
Okay, I could go with that, but let me ask a question. You have under the second tier, you have a residential, anything over 9126 gallons, getting charged 2 cents a gallon almost. The same thing for commercial, but the commercial rate should be higher. It shouldn't be the same.
The theory behind that was that we're charging the commercial the flat base rate that's a higher 1.5 times. I mean,
and if
we could, we could theoretically, yes, we could charge more for a commercial water rate on usage.
I think that that's something that you have to look at, and you have to make sure that you're getting the right amount of money, not just the 2 cents.
You think it should be 1.5 times?
To use less water. If that's one of the things that you're trying to do.
And that's one of the, yes, that's why you see in the residential section when they hit tier three that it pushes them into the next.
Right. And I think that to be consistent with that thinking, you should have a higher rate for your overage on the second tier for the commercial.
You think it should be 1.5 times that rate?
I do.
Okay. That makes sense. So that makes it 0.029. So make it a 2 instead of a 1. And then what do you think for the third tier? Because
one of the things that we met with Dave, he had a whole list of who used how many gallons and for months, and then he had it broken down by years, I think, two years an average. So I would think that if we take a look at that and see how many people used over that much, over 14,000 gallons, then we can decide whether or not that rate should be higher too.
Well, you don't want to make it look like you're basing something on knowing a person or
no, business. You're basing it on usage.
Records, on the usage records.
I don't think it's good to know who meets that record.
What if we take a commercial rate? We had 0.025 in the 14,001 gallon. If we go that everything over 9,126 gallons commercially is 0.025.
2.9.
Okay. If you want to leave it at 2.9 and leave it that way for the rest of the usage.
Yep. Because that's getting high. So let's review it. Residential would be residential not and nonprofits. It's $127 per quarter for use of 9,125 gallons, which again is a standard.
That's per month, isn't it?
No, not per month, per quarter.
Okay, just want to make sure that.
Then if they go over the 9,125, they pay the rate of 0.19, which is just our cost. And then if they go over 14,000 with 1401, we do then push them up to 0.25.
What if we push them to 0.029, the same as the commercial rate?
Okay. Everybody on? So therefore you don't have to program, you don't have all these different rates. Correct. So that makes sense.
And they will pay the commercial unit.
The commercial base for that quarter if they go over that. Okay, and vacant residential is just half the residential rate. Vacant residential is half the residential. Commercial is 1.5 times with the overage of 0.029. And the vacant commercial is 95.25, which is 1.5 times the vacant residential. I would like to put that in the form of a motion. No, I guess, do you want to? Yeah, let's put that in the form of a motion.
I have a motion and a second.
Second.
I have a second by Jill. All in favor? Aye.
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 Opposed? The next thing.
I have a question before I vote.
Okay.
I didn't get a response or a pushback on what I was suggesting, that we raise these rates on a stepped basis.
I suggest that we don't do it because we essentially have done it because we didn't bill the first quarter. So that's a step in itself.
No, I don't agree with that thinking. But.
Well, I'm not in favor of a step, only because of...
It's a loss.
We're going to have some big bills coming. We just, as a result of the suggestion you had made about possibly... checking down by the intersection of 97.
Don't blame Al.
Oh no, it was a good suggestion because we're looking for a water leak. They found a water leak down there. But you know, we had Cam down in there for two different times. We did get the leak cleaned up and they fixed it, but we've got another one. And that one we don't know where it's coming. So we have some issues, and as we're going to see over the next month during our next public hearing, and the report, the troubling report that I saw with the water tower. I just think we're in a bad position, and I don't think there's anything we're going to do that's going to lessen this blow.
Well, that's one of the things that I considered also, because there's that's going to be another hit to the people.
Well, hopefully we'll get some funding for that. Well, that's the purpose.
We would actually need some funding if we were going to go forward with it.
I think
residents in the audience just sent a link to 36 Airbnbs in Marysburg.
Oh,
just meant that.
That's what I was considering the big hit that's going to come, and that's on top of this. And that's why I'm saying make the step up. And I know that you're going
to
have...
This money is to pay for the production of our water.
Right.
The next money is to pay for the infrastructure that needs to repair. Mm-hmm. So taking from saying, well, we're only going to go a little bit on
the production of the water. We still need the production of the water. It's not going to help us when it comes time to start repairing the stuff.
Yeah.
But what it will do is we're going to have to define on how much repair we can afford to do based on how much water we're producing and how much we're charging the customers within the service. We might not get to do as much as we want to do. And we might be patching in until we can get the funding to do it. The raising of the rates to produce the water is substantially different than the rates that are going to be needed to do the repairs, because we're going to be able to pick and choose what repairs we can do and
right.
what we can do.
You
got
a dual charging system.
That
was the other one.
Operation maintenance. When you go to put this water tank in, for example, that's capital expenditure. That should be a different item that gets billed separately. That should be billed every year on the tax bill. That's
capital. It is still going to be the work that people are paying it. So.
Oh yeah, and it's going to be paid. Either way, it's the same people that are paying it, but it's basically two different pockets of the same pair of hands.
Yeah.
The money's coming out of one pocket. Well, it's coming out of the one pair of pants. That's for sure.
Or skirt.
Yes, or skirt.
Skirts don't have pockets.
Yeah, well, it's pants
hard. Skirts usually can come up with the money.
Right. So you answered my question, and we need to raise the rates. There's no question about that. So my vote would be okay.
The next would be a motion to define commercial accounts as those properties within the water district that are on the current assessment roll as commercial code.
Wait a second. You wanted to define the commercial properties, or you want to define commercial?
The people that we're going to charge commercial rates for are going to be those people that
the
are
only on. Reason I'm even hesitating, if you're saying you want to define commercial, don't limit it to the water district, limit it to the town.
No, we're not. The town's not paying the water bill. Only the people within the water district.
I know, but if you're defining something, it might have repercussions down the road.
I'm only defining it for the water district. I'm only defining those properties.
The assessing class codes apply townwide anyway.
Yeah. Okay.
There's no distinction between a.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. What if you get in Lava, a new industrial zone, even though they're not paying. Only the people that are commercial in the water district will pay that rate.
Correct.
But we might as well know what commercial is in the town. And that's what you're saying.
Yeah, it's the same.
It's going to be defined by the assessor's class code.
Right now.
By the assessment law.
Right now, yeah.
That's my motion without all the extra words.
Well, I have a question in regards to that, because, for example, my property is residential and commercial property. And I'm thinking my assessment, I think, is residential, however.
Well, those are the things we'd have to go through and clean up. I mean, there's going to be those that fall between the cracks, but for the purposes of getting started,
right.
That's where we need to get started.
Right. And what in the second part of that, too, is that somebody like me, for example, to look at the numbers and how much the usage is and do it that way.
Mm-hmm.
You can look up my tax and my water bills, and we could know right now if you want. Do you know where they are, though? But I'll look them up. I'm curious because I don't know how much. I don't probably not. I don't think I do.
No,
I'm very conscientious about my own water use.
I have a motion for
are we actually going to try and get the list of commercial properties in the water district by July 1st?
Yes.
The ones defined by on the
what you have to do is each property, I assume on the billing schedule. Section block lot numbers on the billing schedule. Just got to go to the assessment roll and pick up what the class code is.
And there's less than 400, so it's not a large number.
Right. Okay.
I've got that in the form of a motion.
Well, I'll second it.
I have a second by Jane.
What's this motion?
For the definition of a commercial account for the billing of the water district.
Okay.
And it'll be from the class code of the assessment roll.
Okay.
Aye.
Yeah, aye.
All right.
Opposed? Okay. 3.3.
appraisal for the town hall. Does the board want me to move forward with authorization to obtain a commercial appraisal for the town hall located at 210 Bridge Street?
I would make that motion. I agree that you should get it started.
Alan, Bruce?
Can we get a couple quotes on it? Isn't there
professional service?
You don't have to put it out to bid, but I think what we should do is we'll identify two or three reputable MAI appraisers who are competent to do that kind of work, and we'll ask them for a proposal.
Yeah, that's the one.
Because it's going to be two things, and it's going to be dollar what they're going to charge, and there'll be some deviation what they'll charge, but also time.
Mm-hmm.
And the time might be the bigger deviation because mm-hmm. these guys are busy.
Okay, so are you pulling for vote now? We have a first and second.
Is there any other questions on that at all? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Oh, 3.4, our comprehensive plan. Ken, should I read this, being that it's posted, or?
Well, everybody's had it. I don't know that there's a legal requirement then that you read it. I'm assuming the board members have seen it, they're familiar with it.
And the only thing that is different on this, as far as it is, is at the end of the resolution, it's conditional upon the town's receipt of the National Park Service final determination affirming the Upper Delaware Council's substantial conformance with the recommendation.
And we don't have to do that anymore because they did, right?
We've got that from them, yes. They've gone past the 45 day that they've got. I would make a motion to adopt a resolution to adopt the comprehensive plan.
And I'll second it. Really? Yay.
Aye. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed?
Party. Great work.
Now the next work begins. Do we have any other old business that is not on the agenda that I've missed?
Old business, no.
If not, I would open the floor to public comment. Is that a question that she's posing to the board?
Yeah.
Find a value of it.
What was the question?
Linda Slocum is asking what would be the purpose of a commercial appraisal of the town building.
Oh.
Anybody for a comment?
Are you not asking? Oh, that's not.
I've got comments here in the meeting hall.
I agree with the town. Will be defined the Airbnb for the water bill, considered as a commercial space. Yes, it is obviously difficult to identify the Airbnb. But I think the town should work on it. And also, I encourage the town to add a local tax for these Airbnb business because it's. They're using the town resources, and I think they should think additional local tax. I hope the town will try to do that.
Bernie?
Well, I've got a question for the board. This concerns the horse and animal garbage pickup from local restaurants. What is the actual cost of running a horse compared to what the solid farm makes, whereas the horse put it on power, but it's connected.
I don't think that we've got an answer to that at this point in time.
I think that should be an important question.
I know one of the things that I spoke with one of the members of the committee was that they can actually run it, and I think Brandy is still here. She could tell me if I'm wrong, where they could actually operate it by its own product that it was coming out of. But I don't have an answer for that. I could find one out for you, though.
I think that's the town shouldn't be paying for the garbage pickup for the restaurants.
Well, they're not charging for the pickup.
No, they're disposing of it. And if it's costing the rest of the town money, because you don't have all the solar power you put in to run the rest of the stuff.
I can shoot an email out to the Energy Committee and find out an answer for that.
I have a question I'd like to ask or make a comment, public comment.
Yes, Star.
Okay, I just two things. The Narrowsburg Beautification Group, part of our 2021 project, we were supposed to be able to have water down in the gazebo area, and apparently that's locked and nobody can find the key or it's broken or something. But when might that be restored? Because that's actually impeding our completing the project that we wanted to do.
They're working on that today, and they expect it to be completed by Thursday.
Okay, and also we had in that same project that the knotweed was supposed to be mowed by the town, and now we're being told that they don't have a machine to mow. Is that also going to be substituted and corrected?
The mower currently is being worked on because it's broken down, so they are actually working on the mower. It's also paving season, so they are trying to get that back so that they can continue. They were not able to do their right-of-ways also because of the that problem.
Okay, last question I have is the June 1st workshop meeting, there were several comments over and over, it's being recorded. I tried to look into the listing of the different meetings and I don't see it even listed there, let alone have the recorded record. Is that someplace?
I believe it is posted on the website.
No. The video is not up yet.
Oh, the video is not up.
You saved, I have it.
Okay, yeah, it has to be posted up on the website.
Okay, because I looked at the listing of the meetings up that this one was listed, and there was no June 1st meeting at all. So is that's going to be done? Is that what you're saying?
Yep, that's going to be done, yes.
Okay, thank you.
Who does Lisa?
Lisa DeAndrea.
Is her mic off? Brady, I'll get to you after. Okay.
Lisa? Hi, thanks. I have a quick question in reference to the solar farm over on Wood Oak Drive. I know that part of the contract with the town or part of the agreement with the town was that, one, there was supposed to be trees that were put up that were supposed to block the fencing. And the other thing was that the grass in the actual solar array is supposed to be maintained. I'm actually, if I could figure out how to do this on the phone. Well, I'm by the solar farm now and you can see some of the grass, I don't know if you can see that, where the grass is as tall as some of the panels. So the grass has not been mowed at all that I can tell this season. And the trees, half of them are dead and they're not anywhere near sufficient to covering the fencing or covering the solar farm. I know that initially they had been shut down when they first started or when they first tried to start up, and then somehow they got put back on. So I just need to know who's in charge of this, who's maintaining this.
I don't know who's maintaining the solar trees and the grass off the top of my head, but I can find out from the planning board
it was my understanding that Delaware River Solar is responsible for maintaining the grass within the solar farm array, and the trees were supposed to be planted by Delaware Solar. They were supposed to plant 6 to 8 foot trees, if not taller, and they've literally went to Home Depot, picked up Christmas trees, planted them above ground. Half of them are dead. It's just not sufficient.
Well, I will talk with the code enforcement officer and the planning board to see what they've got built in there. I'm sure that there's probably some sort of contingencies on whether the trees live or die. Normally they have some sort of a amount of money in escrow in order to ensure that they can be replanted if they died. So I'm making the assumption that that is probably the same for that, but I would have to check on it to be positive.
Okay. And the other question I had is, I noticed in the beginning of the meeting, you had mentioned that, or somebody had, or excuse me, Ken Baim had written that the solar array or Homeland Farms is seeking an exemption or a further exemption of their taxes or to, you know, lower their taxes. Has that been approved?
And no. What's the status? No, that was one of the things, and let me see if I can find it for you.
That was what I heard.
Yeah, lowering values would result in a solar array with little assessment at the end of the 15-year exemption and would decrease the fees paid to the fire district each year. So that was something
exactly what I was concerned about.
That's why they did not approve that.
Okay. Thank you. And then if you could just let me know, you can email me and let me know who I need to contact in reference to the solar farm and making sure that it's kept up, because the last thing that we need is for the grass to either catch fire or, God forbid, something else happening because it's not being maintained.
Okay. And thank Brandy, you. Did you have something?
Yeah, I couldn't really hear Bernie's whole question. I think so if you could email me that, then that would be great.
Yep.
I think it was about how much it costs the town to run the horse. And I just want to make it clear, it's $68 a year to run the horse if we're just using the electric. If we're using our product that isn't the outgassing, then it's much, much less than $68 a year. All the people who are running the horse are volunteers. Nobody gets any money. It's a lot of time we're spending. I just want to clarify that instead of the same old kind of road downhill here. This is a great thing. It saves people money at the dump. If 40% of your garbage is food, and the residents will start depositing their food scraps this summer, imagine how much money they're gonna save at the landfill, at the dump. So I really don't see the issue, but if you could send me those questions, Ben, that would be great, because I couldn't hear the audience so well.
Yep, I will get them to you.
Thank you.
Tony,
you're muted.
Great. Can you hear me okay?
Yep, you're good.
Okay, great. Is Ken still there? Is Attorney Klein still there?
Yes.
Great. What's the town's recourse regarding the one holdout to give the town a temporary right of way so this work can get done? My understanding is the town has gotten almost $900,000 in a grant. My concern is that there's a time period. Maybe Jane can answer that question, but it's more important that what happens in another month in July that we have the same status, that there's a holdout for whatever reason. And obviously, since I'm a member of the public, it's a sensitive issue since it deals with real estate, but we don't want to have this can kicked down the road, because there's plenty of documents that this dam is not in good condition. I have the documents from the DEC back to the 1990s that the board can have. And I think Jane has that. When I was a council person, I had sent that packet to her, but it's not in good shape. We dodged a bullet a couple of times in 04, 05, and 06 when we had major flooding, and it's certainly an attribute to the town. So that's my question to Attorney Klein, because it's a real estate matter as far as what happens for whatever reason that this person cannot sign off temporarily, get reimbursed, and then the work can be done now as opposed to being delayed. And then there's probably 5 or 6 months where the work can't be done because the weather is inclement.
Well, I think I'm going to answer, and I'll let Ken stop me or change anything. It's easier and quicker for the town to come to a resolution with the property owner and move it forward than trying to think about alternative actions at this time that will delay the project much longer than you could believe.
Tony, Ben's right. The answer is we do have recourse. We have legal recourse. I've briefed the board on that in executive session already, not tonight. But we have recourse. That recourse will be time consuming. It will not result in any resolution that will be quick in any sense of the word. So
I guess my question was, has the town board with council come to some sort of timeline or deadline for the person to move with this project? That's what I'm saying, as opposed to July, September, November, another year has gone by. And obviously this is not gonna age like a fine wine, because every time another year goes by, then there's another, it's an old culvert dam. And as I said, I can certainly send that information, which went back to 1992. So that's my question. Does the town have some sort of deadline as to come to some sort of conclusion with this project?
The town has not formally set a deadline. I think it'd be fair to say that the mindset here is that we're fast approaching that point.
I'm sorry, could you repeat that, Ken?
They have not established a formal deadline as of yet, but we're fast approaching that point.
Okay, fair enough. Thank you. Thank you again, board.
Yes, Mike.
Just a quick question, a point of clarification. In terms of the increase in the water rates, July 1 is a date that's been kicked around tonight. Do the water rates apply to the quarter that we're in currently, or the quarter that starts on July 1?
The quarter that starts July 1.
Okay, yeah. Thank you.
Oh, wait, no, I'm wrong, Mike. I'm wrong. It's right. The bill will come out July 1 for the second 3 months. So that's April, May, June. I was wrong.
So it's a retroactive increase, essentially.
What are his bill in arrears is what they're telling me, Mike.
Okay.
It's always good in arrears. Yeah. So. We get built for what we use.
So I'm going to close the public comment and move into our new business. 5.1, some budget modifications. Building maintenance personnel services, 16-2012, to increase that by $2,000 and decrease contingency 1990.4 by $2,000. This was a result of our winter and our snow shoveling efforts. The other is increase A5182.4 streetlight contractual by $500 and decrease the contingency A1990.4 by 500. Those are 2020 bills that came in after the first of the year. You'll see our streetlight contractual is down to zero on a normal. Sewer fund. 81304 sewage treatment disposal contract contractual, an increase of $10,000 to decrease the sewer capital outlay by $10,000. This is our pumping out of our septic systems, our dousing tank.
It's just misspoken.
We've been having a lot more dousing tanks pumped out. Same thing was down already down at the campground with the amount of people. Power and pumping under the water fund, $10,000, and decreased transmission distribution contractual by $10,000. This is mostly an increase. We had some 2020 NYSEG bills come in for around $2,500, but Perico, our gas company, we've been normally $300-$400 a month. We are up over $700-$900 on some months.
Okay, you want a motion to?
I would like a motion.
So I'll move that we accept the budget modifications as presented.
I'll second that.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? 5.2, a road closure approval. Motion to authorize the Narrowsburg Fire Department to close a portion of the roadway on July 4th. Hold a parade and observation of Independence Day.
And I'll move to accept that.
And a second?
A second.
In favor? Opposed? I've got from, and this went in late, from the Upper Delaware Scenic Byway and the Sullivan County Legislature, working on a pilot program with the river communities to bring solar-powered trash and recycling receptacles to our town. The solar-powered technology alerts a management company when the bins are full and need to be serviced. The cost is high, $5,000 for the units themselves and $1,000 in yearly maintenance, which is why they are testing the program before they expand and commit to it. So it's a program that the Upper Delaware Scenic Byway and the Sullivan County Legislature is doing. We would like to place one of the units in the Narrowsburg area and figured either the lookout area on Main Street deck or the gazebo at the Veterans Park would be best.
Who's the manager?
I'm sorry?
They're going to pay for that?
Yes. Well, that's my understanding, but a resolution to do it would have to include no cost to the town of Custer.
Right.
I just had two questions. Who is the managing company and how much is it going to cost us?
Well, it's going to cost us nothing as far as our resolution goes.
And do we know who the managing company is?
They have not said who the managing company is.
So they just want us to pilot to see if
they're looking for a pilot.
I will agree to, I'll move that we accept to be a pilot user of the solar-powered trash and recycling receptacle at no cost to the town.
Provided there is no cost to the town.
And there's no
bingo.
And no contingency that we have to buy it.
And no contingency. Good, good.
I'm about getting run out on a rail. I have got a motion and a second. Second by Jill. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? 5.4, the Upper Delaware Council's Technical Assistance Grant. Does the board wish to apply to the grant? And if the board wishes to apply to the grant, what they would like it to be used for? One of the discussions was the zoning update as a result of our comprehensive plan.
Which is one of the guidelines that they propose in the notification of the grant. I think it has to be done because we started it and it's not completed.
Well,
what benefit does it have to the town?
It's going to pay, we can use it as pay for the consultant that we hire to utilize taking the amendments that are in the comprehensive plan and redrafting some of the points of our zoning that need to be updated, either as a result of the comprehensive plan or those things that have become outdated that we need to address. Basically it's,
or contradictions. There's contradictions in the
plan. Right.
Like defining commercial. That would happen here.
So what it's doing is it's decreasing the cost to the town to do these things by whatever amount we get from the Upper Delaware Council.
Okay.
I move that we apply for our UDC technical assistance grant for the purpose of updating the zoning codes.
I have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? 5.5.
Jill.
5.5. Speaking with the highway superintendent, he is looking to purchase a road street sweeper. Apparently, he's had an issue with his also. He's had to rent one. He does know where there's a couple out there. He's looking for approval to purchase a road street sweeper in an amount not to exceed $25,000 and to be in accordance with the provisions of the town's procurement policy. And he does have the money within his budget to do it under his equipment.
I'll second it.
Any questions on it at all? I have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
And opposed? setting a public hearing for the improvements to the water system. Ken, I'm going to defer to you again. Do I need to read this off?
No, I mean, the whole point of it is to schedule a public hearing on the 22nd at 6:30. This is a public hearing that's required pursuant to Section 202-B of the town law. That's to get the public comment and input before the town board makes findings of public necessity, of public benefit, and before the board can and render a final order to actually authorize the project. Following that, there would also be a bond resolution adopted. But even that, while it all does the authorization, you are not committed to spending one dime yet.
And the public should just know at the public hearing, a representative from Delaware Engineering will come with a PowerPoint presentation. I think a PowerPoint, but there'll be a presentation. Yeah. It should be a nice presentation. There'll be two members from Delaware Engineering that will come. So I'm sure that it'll be a...
We want to do that as a hybrid meeting again or just an in-person public hearing?
No, in-person. Hybrid meetings.
With Zoom.
Oh, I think it should be both. For those that still feel uncomfortable coming out, right?
In person.
It'll be in person. No, I think that's unfair to those that are not comfortable. So, okay, so I will move.
Make a motion regarding calling for the public hearing for the improvements to the water district, which will be on the 22nd of June, 6:30.
Yes.
Jane has that motion on the
floor. I'll second that.
Jill has a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed.
And before you move on, just so everybody's clear, so what's going to happen that night is you're going to start your meeting at 6. We're going to do the seeker, complete the seeker proceeding, which started last year on the thing. Likely result, I think, based on the engineer's recommendations with a negative declaration, but that will be your determination, obviously, when you get to that point. Then you'll hold your public hearing with the presentation from Delaware Engineering, the PowerPoint presentation that Dave Chang was talking about. After you get the public comment, then we'll be in a position to close the public hearing and continue with the meeting, and that's when you can, if you want to, take the action to make the findings, adopt the final order. Those documents are all being prepared by the bond council, as I understand. With the engineer, and then after that, do the bond resolution itself. And that will then put the engineers in the position where they can start to pursue a financing application with Environmental Facilities Corporation to see whether they can get you some favorable rate as opposed to, I don't know whether this would be eligible for the hardship, which I don't think it is, 0%, but you might be able, might wind up eligible for the reduced rate, which is the subsidized rate. And also we'll put them in a position where they can start pursuing some grant money.
Is Joe going still?
Yes, Jane, I'm here.
Oh, good. Okay, then you heard what Ken had to say. Great, thank you. Yes, thank you for sticking around.
Oh, no problem.
He's from Delaware Engineering.
Oh. What was his name?
Joe Golan, G-O-L-O-N.
You don't have any disagreement with what I said, do you, Joe? It's Ken.
Nope, from what I heard, you said everything correctly.
Okay, good. I want to make sure you and I are on the same page, because if we're not, we're all in a world of trouble, man.
5.7, make a motion to set a special meeting for June 22nd, 2021 at 6 p.m.
6 p.m. I'll move that.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
Aye.
I've got one more thing under new business.
I have two.
Okay, good. No, that's what I was going to defer to you.
Well, I have a question. I don't think it really is a town issue, and I have to hear that. I had a resident call me about all these birds that are on the roofs of all the houses. We can't do anything about that.
Excellent.
No, you know, have you seen them?
Oh my they're gosh,
almost the they're scary.
They were in the tree on the next to
me. Upper Delaware. No sun.
They're just getting sun. It depends. But there's nothing that we as a town.
I don't think you have any bird control legislation or authorization.
So,
Yeah, most of them are protected anyway. You're right about that.
Okay, so I asked the question. The next issue is, the next issue to consider is that the Trust and Energy Committee has been working with NYSIG, I guess. I don't know who. And anyway, we have an opportunity. There's a 20,000. Brandy, are you still here? There's a $20,000 opportunity to improve the streetlight usage with the Smart Cities application. And we, as a town board, can decide what we would like done with that $20,000. It actually can be more if we are willing to pay something as well. I think you want to take over?
Well, this is part of what came up at the last meeting regarding putting a Wi-Fi on Main Street. Since then, some other things have come up. One being possibly lights down in the playground area, and also possibly putting some sort of a camera system at the playground area. One of the other things that, and I was just going through my notes, and then because I was talking with Jane earlier about it, mostly because of the playground area. But we do have a contingency that is left over. And the money that's left over, we can use. This is money that we've already put in for as far as what we were going to do with the streetlights. And then that could be used elsewhere so that the town could actually purchase, say, the streetlights. Then our highway department could actually do the installation of them. And then
we could put the application on. The new light.
You could put them on the new lights also. And then you could also use that $20,000 Smart Cities grant that Brandy was talking about. That's what reduced our cost for the Main Street Wi-Fi. That's how those numbers that I showed you earlier tonight.
I did find out that $20,000 may not be applied to installation of new street lights. We have to pay for that.
Right, but we could.
You have contingency.
We could have used money out of the contingency, then turn around and use that $20,000 to put what you would want, say down in the park area, in the playground area.
There's a couple lights that have been put up that don't even work.
Yeah, they're due to come back on those when they're going to do the street, the parking lot, and then put the Main Street fixtures in. So we do have an idea of which ones they are. But that's something for the board to think about also is if you want to do something at the playground area.
I think last time we met, I'll speak for myself, I thought the proposal was for the town board to spend $20,000 to get Wi-Fi on Main Street. That's wrong. We received $20,000.
Well, we would spend about $16,000 of our money. Yeah, it wouldn't that be would the $20,000 would be used to defer the cost of it.
We're talking about four. I think that as a town, we've heard numerous complaints from residents down on the flats that there are some things unsavory going on, and maybe we need more lights down there. You disagree?
I disagree.
Okay, I don't live on the flats. I'm only
my mother chilling. Lives on the flats. I hear everything that goes on down there. Very much going on down there.
Do we have enough lights down
there's
at the playground?
Lights down there.
On the playground?
No one goes to the playground.
Don't look at me. I'm almost 60.
People go to our playground.
I'm older than you. Well, okay. So what do you want to do?
Well, that's just something for the board to think about. We don't have to make a decision on it tonight, but I can.
We don't lose the $20,000. There's not a deadline for this $20,000.
I'll find out.
Okay.
That's not one that I'm aware of, but
if you could find out before the June 22nd meeting, that'd be good.
We can do that.
Okay.
I'd like to bring up, I've gotten a couple of emails and photos, and there's a lot of unsavory graffiti now under the Narrowsburg Bridge.
And the railroad trestle.
And the railroad trestle, yeah. And so, don't know how we can handle this, but it needs, I believe, to be addressed.
I did have that was forwarded to me from the town clerk's office on somebody that was able to get some license plates of some people that is being turned over to the state police.
Oh,
we'll see if we don't know where they're from yet. I don't know if they'll tell me where they're from, being that I'm not a police officer.
Not anymore.
But, you know, if it's somebody local, good. If it's somebody that's not from around here, I know that I was speaking with the highway superintendent and there was some more complaints of parking in the Veterans Park. So maybe we need to reestablish our look at the P gates. And
there was a lot going on this weekend down there, and it was pretty unruly from what I've heard. A lot of complaints about it. And so the whole place is packed. And
maybe we can
work on that.
We'll get them up.
Okay. They said that they would install them.
Yeah, the highway will install them. And Don had said that one of the complaints was, you know, a resident business that was unable to get to the back.
Okay, I will.
Yeah.
No, it's
true. Gotta be with the smart
cities. I'll contact the right person for the time. Okay.
Is there any other new business that we've missed? We're going to be entering an executive session. So before we do that, I will open the floor to more public comment.
The water district. What's the health department saying about the proposed upgrades? What's the health department requiring? You don't have a choice about it.
I would have to defer to looking at the report again, to tell you the truth, Bernie. And I don't, does Joe, is that even something? We can get back to Joe.
Yeah, what was the question?
What's the requirements on upgrading the water system?
Oh. Hold on 1 second, Ed. I got a question on the floor.
I don't know the answer.
You 1 second.
It would be something you really want to know before you have the public hearing.
Vicki?
Yes. I know the board controls the budget. And I do start holding on the board when you make decisions on, you know, using money wisely. Ellsberg is not only the main street, there's more than main street. So I just want to remind the board. And also, when I read the newspaper, there is a new fund released from the federal ARPA, about $14.6 million. Just wondering. When the town will get it and what the plan for that
is. I don't think we've put plans together for what it is. It's going to be put out. I think the first part comes this fall, possibly. But we don't have a set date on it.
I don't know how much we're getting.
160.
Yeah, 160,000. Something like that. I actually thought it was 140, but whatever. It's not as much money as it sounds. Yes. I think they did everything by population and we're the second smallest populated town in the county, I think. Is that still good?
Yes.
Ed Krause?
Yes.
You're on.
Could I speak briefly about the cost per gallon of the water before we close down?
Sure.
Well, you know, historically, the water department had two people working for him. Am I correct?
That is correct.
And now, as I understand, we have four people working.
That also is correct. You've got three employees and one person that is an acting superintendent.
And how long is that going to continue?
That's going to continue until we can get somebody that actually comes in from the three that are there that can take over the position with the certifications that are required from the state and demonstrate the ability to run the department.
Well, this has been going on for a long time. You would think that people who you have there who have been there long enough would be able to take over that position.
The problem also, Ed, is licensing. They need to be licensed by the state. They're in the process of doing that.
But you people are the bosses in charge of this. You know, and I think you ought to take control of this situation. You got more vehicles now in the water department than you've ever had. I could tell you a story about a leak out here on Fourth Avenue that you wouldn't want to hear about. I mean, the board has to start paying attention to what's going on, and I don't know how you do it, I mean, besides going out and looking and seeing. And that's where the cost is coming from. A lot of it's coming from, you know, when you're talking about raising the rates. That's where it's coming from.
Actually, Ed, the majority of your cost is not coming from, and I don't mean to argue with you on this, it's not okay. coming from the personnel payments. It's coming from things like the disability insurance, the health insurance, the cost to repair the infrastructure, because nothing has been done with the infrastructure. And it's part of the problem is we were running a two-man department when it should have been three or more. We've got an old system, and the board is making some very hard decisions, and we all get along real good here tonight, and we put on a nice front that we're going to raise the rates, and we tell you how sorry we are. You didn't hear all the arguing that got us to this point. We understand that it is hard, but we have to take an honest look about what's been done with this system
not been done
over the last 20 years. So, you know, I'm not going to say the last 10 years. I was a supervisor here 15 years ago. There's things that should have been done
in
that
were
not done.
Charlie Knapp, the tower up there, the tank, the water tank, was always cleaned and repainted every 6 years. You know, it's been let go. Well, I know you didn't let it go. You folks didn't let it go, but it's been let go. And, you know, but by the same token, you know, I see all these people and this PAM coming in and all these expenses. You know, we're in a position where, you know, people who are paying for this, it's getting tougher and tougher and tougher.
That is understood. We just had Tam here on 97, Ed. You know, I haven't got the bill for it yet. But the reason that we utilize a company like Tam is because we only have a three-man department with an acting superintendent. And we couldn't have stopped the leak that was underneath 97 with our manpower and our equipment. It just wouldn't have been done. But in less than a day, we had extremely little disruption. Unfortunately, things have changed. The regulations have changed. The confined quarters has changed. The training has changed. It's not a good excuse for it, but
no.
We're making the changes.
But I know what I also, you know, I could tell you a lot of stories about what I see, but I will not do that. So anyway, thank you for letting me vent a little bit.
That's good. I'm sure it's not going to be the last time I hear from you. I encourage you to come.
Me too.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Question about the notice of the public hearing. It states the water tower, all that. But the installation of replacement of fire hydrants, valves, and mains, wasn't recently, at least I know, a half a dozen fire hydrants and valves, not the main, but the valves and the fire hydrant itself were just recently replaced. Would those get reused? Or are the fittings not going to accommodate the new main that would be put in?
No, they, as far as I know, they would be okay to still use.
Okay.
Yeah, they wouldn't be ripping up stuff that we just did.
Yeah, so right. Those are nice, beautiful red ones. I like them. My dog likes them. All right, thank you.
Any other comment from the audience? If not, I will make a motion to enter into executive session for the purpose of discussing possible litigation.
I'll second.
We have a second by Jane. All in favor?
Aye.
8:13.
Thank you, Paul.
Thank you. Good to see you. Haven't seen you for a while. Are things going well?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Good.
Summer is here. So. I move that we come out of executive session.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
I move that we adjourn the meeting.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed?
Me. 24 p.m.